talking about the circuit of beneficence today. So without too much ado, we want to get started, but if you notice there's a little QR code thing out of that on your notepaper. If you have one of these smartphones, you can just click a picture of that with your QR reader, and then the notes will come up onto your smartphone. We're living in a great technological age, and so we have one right here. We want to zoom in on that, take a picture, see if it works. It's a grand experiment. If it fails, oh well, at least you tried. But come on in, we're going to get started with the circuit of beneficence. Basically, what we're going to be doing is giving a theological or philosophical framework for practical Christianity in the Seventh-day Adventist Church. I think there are oftentimes Seventh-day Adventist mindset is such that we have a message, which we do, and a mission, which we do, and then our mission is to simply articulate a message and not participate in anything else. So what exactly should our work look like, and what are the framework, what philosophy underlies it, what is our theology that goes before our practice? So before we get started with anything else, I'd like to just start briefly with a word of prayer, so would you please bow your head with me. Dear Heavenly Father, I want to thank you so much for the opportunity to spend these few minutes together, exploring deep thoughts from your word and from your inspired counsel and spirit of prophecy. Lord, help us to understand what the message is for our time, and help us to be part of that entire restoration of the universe that you have in store for us. We pray in Jesus' name. I'm going to start with a slight confession. I have always really enjoyed writing about why I very much appreciate what she had to say, and the way in which she said it, I was always very drawn to. But in my younger days, which I'm getting to the point in life where I can refer to my younger days, I would read the writings of Mrs. White and kind of skip past the floofy stuff. Kind of like the birds and the songs and the love and the children and the lambs, that kind of warm, fuzzy kind of stuff. I wanted to get to like the identity of Antichrist and 144,000 and the great prophetic. I wanted to get to the good stuff, you know? But recently, in studying, we have a weekly prayer meeting and the seed in Fremont where I'm a pastor, and we've been studying Desire Ages. And recently, quote, a passage that originally left just a glancing blow in my mind, hit me squarely in the eyes. And everything that we're going to be talking about today comes from, is derived from that passage, which in your notes is right there, the very first thing in the introduction. It comes from Desire Ages, pages 20 and 21. So I'm just going to read to you three paragraphs from the Desire Ages, and that will set our course for where we're going today. It says, there is nothing save the selfish heart of man that lives unto itself. No bird that cleaves the air, no animal that moves upon the ground, but ministers to some other life. There is no leaf of the forest, or lowly blade of grass, but has its ministry. Every tree and shrub and leaf pours forth that element of life, without which neither man nor animal could live. And man and animal, in turn, minister to life, tree and shrub and leaf. And you think this is a grand opus on the life of Christ. Why is she talking about trees and shrubs and leaves? What is she talking about? She goes on. The flowers breathe fragrance and unfold their beauty and blessing to the world. The sun sheds its light to gladden a thousand worlds. The ocean itself, the source of all of our springs and fountains, receives the streams from every land, but takes to, what's the next word?
Give.
Takes to give. This is going to be an ongoing idea throughout this seminar. Takes to give. The mists ascending from its bosom fall in showers to water the earth, that it may bring forth and bud. The angels of glory find their joy in giving. Giving love and timeless watch, tireless watch here, souls that are fallen and unholy. Heavenly beings move the hearts of men. They bring to this dark world life from the courts above. By gentle and patient ministry, they move upon the human spirit to bring the lost into a fellowship with Christ, which is even closer than they themselves can know. Which there's a whole sermon right in that phrase, that they have tireless care that we can get connected to God in such a way that they cannot even personally appreciate. But they know it's a benefit to us, so they just give for our benefit. Goes on. But turning from all lesser representations, we behold God in Jesus. So you notice there's a progression. It starts with like shrubs and trees and leaves and flowers, then up to men and angels. And all of the great principle, which is the law of life for the universe. What we just talked about there, the trees, the shrubs, the flowers, the birds, apparently is the great principle, the law of life for the universe. She articulates. All things Christ received from God, but he took to give. Very simple premise. So, in the heavenly courts, in his ministry for all created beings, through the beloved Son, the Father's life flows out to all. And through the Son, it returns in praise and joyous service, a tide of love to the great source of all. And thus, through Christ, the circuit of beneficence is complete, representing the character of the great giver, capital G, refer to God as the great giver. And you can picture a circuit, an electric circuit. He says, in Christ, this circuit is now complete. Everything flows through and everything flows out. And there's apparently in heaven a harmonious principle where everyone takes only to give. This is the great operating premise of God's heavenly universe. The grand principle of life. Mrs. White's assertion, by the way, that selfish beneficence is the great principle, is the law of life in the universe, is firmly founded in Scripture. Look at a few of these texts. Go to the Apostle Paul. Romans chapter 13, verse 8. He says, owe no one anything except to do what? To love one another. And then he says this, for he who loves one another has done what? Has fulfilled the law. Now, I know there are some dads who struggle with this. Like, if you talk to a doctor, and somebody says, yes, but you're just supposed to love, that's the law. And you're like, ah, that is the Bible. How does this fit into our understanding of our proclamation? What are we supposed to do with this? Paul goes on to say, Galatians chapter 5, verse 14. For all the law, and of course he's speaking of the Old Testament law, the Ten Commandment law, the very law of God, all the law is fulfilled in one word. What is that word? Of course, love. Even in this, you shall love, and you would think it would be the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, with all your mind. That's not what it says. All the law is fulfilled in love, particularly you shall love your what? Neighbor. That's it. All the law is wrapped up in this one principle. Just to think it, you know, Paul could be off, you know, he's totally conditioned. Hey, maybe he just had this. He was solid. Mrs. White got this from Scripture and from direct inspiration. But notice that Jesus himself makes this point. Matthew chapter 7. This is in the Sermon on the Mount. Therefore, whatever you want men to do to you, do also to them. What do we call this typically? The golden rule. Then he says, for this is what? The law and the prophets. If I were to summarize all the law and the prophets, Christ said, Paul says, if I were to summarize all the law of God, Mrs. White says, the entire principle of the universe, the great operating scheme of God's government is simply this. Give unto others. That's it. Well, let's bring And his job was to lead the people through him to Jesus. He was part of that circuit of beneficence, receive to give. But at some point, he just wanted to take. And there's a short in the circuit of beneficence. This is the origin of sin. There's a short circuit in this great principle of heaven. Therefore, so what we see here now, I'll break it down in just a second. Therefore, he misrepresented God, attributing to him the desire for self-exaltation. With his own evil characteristics, he sought to invest alone in Creator. Thus, he deceived angels. Thus, he deceived men. So notice he's got an operating principle that his government is going to run with, and that is selfishness. God has an operating principle called selflessness. And now you have these two grand principles in competition for loyalty in God's universe. Selflessness versus selfishness. And notice that's the principle difference. And therefore, out of that, Satan derived a policy. He did something. He put this principle into action. Therefore, he misrepresented God. Okay, so he said, he understood there's selfishness going. But if somebody just says, I'm just trying to be selfish, no one comes to your aid with that. So in order to implement this, he took that and put it onto Christ. So basically, God's saying, I am selfless. Satan's saying, no. I am selfless. I say, no. This is true freedom. Satan says, no. This is true freedom. And he started to misrepresent, he started to confuse people about what the great principle of heaven really is and who really represented the true character of God. John chapter 8, we're going to do a little brief history of the fall of Satan, otherwise known as the great controversy. We're going to need our Bibles, or if you don't have them, the summaries are written right there in your notes. But in John chapter 8, verse 44, I'd love to do a whole study of John 8 and the implications there, but go to your Bible, John chapter 8. And here Jesus is having one of many interactions with scribes and priests and Pharisees and rulers, leaders of the law. And here he says an interesting statement. We'll start with verse 38. Let's start with 37. I know that you are Abraham's descendants, but you seek to kill me. Because my word has no place in you. I speak what I have seen with my father, and you do what you've seen with your father. Notice Christ is setting up a dichotomy. I have my father, and you have your father. They catch this, and they answer and said to him, Abraham is our father. Jesus said to them, I love Jesus' pure, simple logic. Watch this. Jesus said to them, if you are Abraham's children, you would do the works of Abraham. I can tell you're not his because you don't do what he did. Very simple. But now you seek to kill me, a man who has told the truth which I heard from God. Abraham did not do this. Abraham never once tried to kill me. You're trying to kill me. You're not from my father. You have a different father. You do the deeds of your father. They said, we are not born of fornication. We have one father, God. Jesus said to them, if God were your father, you would love me. I proceeded forth in the name of God, nor have I come of myself, but he sent me. Why do you not understand my speech? Because you are not able to listen to my word. You, here's our key, verse 44, you are of your father. Now he identifies who that other father is. Who is that other father? The devil. You are the father of the devil, and the desires of your father you want to do. So the same desires that were in him, I recognize in you. He was a, what's the word? Murderer from the beginning. And does not stand in truth, because there is no truth in him. When he speaks a lie, he speaks from his own resources, for he is a liar and the father of it. Which drives me to this question. I don't want to say always, but for a long time, what in the world does Satan actually do wrong? think about this. Who did he actually execute in heaven? Well, it's good that Jesus used the word murder, and Jesus defines the word murder for us in the exact same book. So, I mean, go back to the book of Matthew, sorry. In Matthew chapter 5, part of the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus defines what he means when he employs the term murder. What is he thinking of when he thinks of murder? Humanity thinks physically taking someone's life and ending, killing. Notice what Jesus had a deeper understanding of the law than that, which he came to articulate. Matthew chapter 5, look at verses 21-22. You have heard that it was said to those old, you shall not murder, and whoever murders will be in danger of the judgment. But I say to you that whoever is angry with his brother without a cause shall be in danger of the judgment. And whoever says to his brother, Raka, shall be in danger of the council. But whoever says, you fool, shall be in danger of hell fire. Jesus basically is teaching that a murderous intent is tantamount to murder itself. And notice that Jesus in his dialogue with the Pharisees says, the desires of your father you want to do. Now, they hadn't killed Jesus yet, but he saw it in them, right? That I know where this is leading. The same principle that stirs you stirred your father. And Jesus says that murder actually goes deeper, goes down to the very motive, goes to what's going on inside of you. Now, I would be very upset if I was charged for a crime that I only thought about. In our reckoning, this is unfair, this is unjust, it cannot be done. You actually have to do a thing wrong to be wrong, right? But in God's government, every secret intent, every motive, every thought will be brought into judgment. Of course, we can't see God, but God can. And he looked right in the heart of Lucifer and he said, that's a murderer. That's a capital offense. So why didn't God just kill them when he saw that he was a murderer? Isaiah chapter 14. Dig this in a little bit deeper. Isaiah chapter 14, starting verse 12. Commenting on the fall of Lucifer, how you are fallen from heaven, the Lucifer, son of the morning, how you are cut down to the ground, you who weaken nations. For you have said, look at the next few words, in your heart. Where is he saying these grand things that we always read about? He was saying them in his heart. For you said in your heart, I will ascend in heaven, I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I also will sit on the mount of the congregation on the farthest sides of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High. But all of that grand, pompous wording was going on where? In his heart. Verse 15. Yet you shall be brought down to Sheol, the lowest depths of the pits. And we often stop there. I'm going to extend this down to the next verse. Because I think this is the key to our question. If God can see the heart, see that he was a rebel, see that he was a murderer, and that his way would end in literal death, why not? There are people asking this question. If God could see the heart and knew that he would kill people, why didn't he end him right then and there? The scripture gives us an answer. Right here it is, verse 16. Those who see you will gaze at you. What are some synonyms for gaze? To stare, what else? To watch, to look, to study. Those who see you, your associates, will watch you. They will gaze at you. Why? And what are the next word? And consider. They're going to watch what you do, and they're going to think about what you're doing. Saying, is this the man who made the earth tremble, who shook kingdoms? You know, there's a whole lot of angelic beings, heavenly intelligences, who knew Lucifer before he was a bad guy. And they're going to watch his entire principle, his operating principle of selfishness, run its course, and then they will see for themselves what this principle results in. And there's our answer for why God did not eliminate him the instant he saw into his heart and we let him know he was a murderer. Because though he sees, others could not see. And he says, those who know you are going to look at you, watch you, think about you, and ask very important questions. Is it possible that this is the same individual? Let's go to the book of Ezekiel. Ezekiel chapter 28. like that of existence. Ezekiel chapter 28, starting with verse 14. You were the anointed cherub who covers. And of course, the Seventh Adventist, our mind goes back to the Ark of the Covenant, and those two angels with older wings right there, shining glory. He was one of those. I established you, some verses say, for so I ordained you. He was an ordained minister. Goes on. You were on the holy mountain of God. You walked back and forth in the midst of fiery stones. You were perfect in your ways from the day you were created till the iniquity was found. Where was it found? In you. Notice the same thing from Isaiah 14, that it was all within him. It was inside him. For he said in his heart, it was found in you. Goes on. Till iniquity was found in you. And here's the answer to the question I addressed it with all the time. What did he actually do wrong in heaven? Verse 16. By the abundance of your trading. Some versions say merchandise. What? I thought Jesus said he was a murderer. Here Ezekiel says he was a businessman. Merchandise, commerce, trade, traffic. Let's keep going. By the abundance of your trading, you became filled with violence. And where was violence? Within. And you sinned. Therefore, for that reason, I cast you as a profane thing out of the mountain of God. I destroyed your glory cherub from the midst of fire stones. Verse 17, your heart was lifted up because of your beauty. You corrupted your wisdom for the sake of your splendor. I cast you to the ground. I laid you before kings that they might what? Gaze at you, behold you, so that they can watch you. Same exact rationale from Isaiah. Goes on. You defiled your sanctuary by the multitude of your iniquities. Iniquity is another word for sin, right? The great things you were doing, these transgressions, by the iniquity of your, here's our word again, trading. The sin, the iniquity that God passed out of them was trading something, merchandise, selling something. What in the world? What was that? And the King James is traffic, T-R-A-F-F-I-C-K. Traffic. Therefore, I brought fire from your midst, I devoured you, and I turned you to ashes upon the earth in the sight of all who saw you. And notice verse 19. All who knew you among the peoples are astonished at you. Apparently, the discipline doled out to Lucifer for his great iniquity was not merely punitive, but it was also redemptive for the others around him. He said, I'm doing this so that they can see, they can gaze at you, they can consider you, they can be astonished at you, they can learn what was inside of you, but I need to give it time to come on the outside of you. God can see in the heart, we can't. So he gives some time. Now, fascinating enough, if you look at this word up, T-R-A-F-F-I-C-K, in your little LG White app, or whatever thing you have, you'll find one reference to that word. And it's from 7 down to 5 commentary, the volume 4, page 1163. She comments directly on this thing. What was the sin? What was the traffic that got him kicked out of it? She says, in this place, traffic is the emblem of corrupt administration. It denotes the bringing of self-seeking into spiritual offices. And it's from his office as a covering chair, where he was supposed to received to give glory, he started siphoning it off to himself. And that's the traffic that he was doing. He was peddling an idea counter to God's circuit of commandments. It denotes the bringing of self-seeking into spiritual offices. Nothing in spiritual service is acceptable to God except the purposes and works that are for the good of the universe. To do good to others. Sounds like Paul, sounds like Jesus, sounds like Ellen White way back in the beginning of all floofy words about shrubs and birds and grass. To do good for others will redound to the glory of God. And notice how many times she uses the principle word next. The principles of Satan's working in heaven are the same principles by which he works through human agents in this world. It is through these corrupting principles that every early empire and church has been increasingly corrupted. It is by the working out of these principles that Satan deceives and corrupts the whole world from beginning to end. His operating premise is selfishness, and that principle has corrupted the whole world. This is what Jesus is teaching here. He is continuing the same policy working, originally begun in the heavenly universe. He is energizing the whole world with his violence, with which he corrupted the world in the days of Noah. Again, notice the identical rationale for the expulsion rather than destruction, that they might gaze at you. What the heavenly intelligences could not at first see in the heart of Lucifer was finally manifested at Calvary. And just a little aside on this, of course, people had died, thousands, perhaps millions upon millions of people had died before Jesus died on the cross. But could not Satan have made a logical claim and said, well, sure they died, they all sinned. Right? And it's God's law that says the wages of sin is what? Death. It's like, yeah, I had to handle all those deaths. But it wasn't murder. I'm executing God's law. I'm just showing you what your God is all about. But when Jesus came and lived a sinless life, rebuffed every advance of Satan, put down every temptation, lived an untainted existence, and Lucifer killed him too, something lit up in the minds of those who knew him earlier. Watch this. This is from Desire Ages 761, about the moment Jesus died on the cross. It says this: Satan saw that his disguise was torn away. His administration was laid open before the unfallen angels, before the heavenly universe. Think about this. Even for 4,000 years of Earth's history of watching these principles, they didn't fully comprehend what was in his heart until they saw the cross of Calvary. They said, wow, now we can see that he really was a murderer from the very beginning. Watch this. His administration was laid up before the unfallen angels, before the heavenly universe. He had revealed himself as a murderer. Now the violence that was within, way up in heaven, was unleashed on the sinless Son of God, and they actually saw the murder take place. He had revealed himself as a murderer. By shedding the blood of the Son of God, he had uprooted himself from the sympathies of the heavenly beings. Wrap your mind around that, what it's saying. For at least 4,000 years of human misery, unfallen angels, sinless beings, still had some element of sympathy for Satan. It's as though they're turning to God and saying, look, we're on your side, but let's at least hear him out. Which is exactly what Isaiah and Ezekiel were saying. That's why he cast him out, so that they might gaze at you and consider you. They need to think about you and understand where your principles lean. Notice this. Sympathy for heaven. Henceforth, his work was restricted. And notice this, on an arbitrary degree of God, you can't come near my angels talking to them anymore. You look at the book of Job, apparently had free access once he gained control of the earth to come and talk to the angels. And they were straight inside, but they were hearing him out. But henceforth his work was restricted. Whatever attitude you might assume, he could no longer await the angels, they came from the heavenly courts, but before the accused Christ brought underneath clothes, the garments of lapis and the defile of sin. The last link of sympathy between Satan and the heavenly world was broken. Apparently he was allowed in those meetings so that his principles could be more fully revealed, and every being who would live beyond the end of sin would have a clear picture of where sin would lead, so that it would never choose to participate in it again. Angels needed to see, and this is the point I'm trying to make here from this whole little review of the fall of Satan. Angels needed to see the principles demonstrated in the life. Do you see what I'm saying? They needed to see the principles of Satan's government live out in the life. And then they could say, ah, Satan's character was fully revealed at the cross in the exact same moment, so was the character of God fully revealed to the intelligences for the very first time. Before that, it had all been theory. But Christ came to give himself. And they saw the contrast between the great giver, the one who would give even the life of his own dear son, in contrast with the one who would take everything, including the life of God's dear son. So the first time they saw the clear contrast between the character and the principles of God's government and the character and principles of Satan and his God. It's fascinating. But we go on. So now the question is, why not destroy Satan even now? Finally, the intelligent, unfallen beings see for themselves. It's like they can turn to God, and my sanctified imagination says, Lord, we didn't understand who Lucifer really was. Thank you so much for giving us time to see for ourselves where his administration. But we now know that you are right. He's a murderer. He deserves to die. Though we loved him, we understand the justice in this strange work of yours. Go ahead. Execute justice. And you can almost imagine God having to say, great, thank you for finally being on board after thousands of years. I really appreciate that. Now, I want to bring some of his loyal subjects right back here. And Gabriel's like, huh? You want to bring sinners back here? Because you know, it's not called the plan of destruction, it's called the plan of salvation. And unless something is saved, the plan isn't complete. It's more than just destroying sin, it actually involves saving sinners. Now think about this. And this is where it gets the next idea. While the angels can now clearly see why Satan should be destroyed, they still need to see evidence that we should live. Think about it. Like, all right, we've seen what he's all about, and he's not ever coming back. No more sympathy for him. God's like, good, now I'm going to take some followers and bring them back. Like, slow down. We need to see some evidence of which principle they operate their lives on. Which is what this quite clearly says. Look, the very happy, the last thing, sympathy was broken. The very next words. Yet Satan was not then destroyed. The angels did not even then understand all that was involved in the great controversy. Apparently, there's more involved in the great controversy than ending Satan. Goes on. The principles at stake were to be more fully revealed. And for the sake of man, Satan's existence must be continued. As Seventh-day Adventists, we can just have all this beautiful sentence. Notice how crazy you sound when you say that. Why did that terrible train engine happen? Why did that murder happen? Why did that disease happen? Why does God just fix it all? Why doesn't he end Satan now? And you say, oh, good news, brother. It's good for Satan to be alive. It's in our best interest. Huh? You people are crazy. If you have the audacity to say that, you better have a good theological backup for why you believe it. Mrs. White makes this point. Yet Satan was not destroyed, but for the sake of man, it must be continued. Man, as well as angels, must see the contrast between the prince of light and the prince of darkness, and he must choose whom he will serve. Are we going to serve the selfless creator or the selfish corrupter? Which will be the principle of our lives? And apparently, the angels are watching. Not for evidence that Satan should die, but evidence that we should live. Goes on. Perhaps, well, this is, I like this little thing, Gabriel's concern is more than merely you're getting into heaven. He's concerned that you actually fit into heaven once you get there. Right? Our concern, and I'll tell you, I think sometimes we have a very selfish religion. It's all about, Lord, what does it take for me to get into heaven? I want those streets of gold, I want a mansion, I want to have, you know, I want to eat from the tree of life, I want to relax, I want to get out of work, I want to have all of that. When do I get there? How do I get in? Gabriel said, stop! We got to make sure they fit in before you let them get in. You see the difference? The salvation of Jesus entails more than merely getting said, to me, who am less than the least of all the saints, this grace is given, that I should preach among the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ. But that is not the end of the sentence. Comma, verse 9. And to make all see what is the fellowship of the mystery. He's like, so beyond just preaching this message, he's like, and I want to make all see what is the fellowship of this mystery. There's some deep wisdom of God, some mystery that needs revealing. Goes on, verse 10. Which from the beginning of the ages has been given to God, who created all things through Christ Jesus. Verse 10 is our punchline. To the intent that now the manifold wisdom of God might be made known by the church to the principalities and powers in the heavenly places. Paul uses very long sentences. Peter says he writes things that are sometimes hard to understand, so we're going to break this down. It says, to the intent that now, the manifold wisdom of God, a manifold simply means a complex device, right? A complicated, deep thing. This wisdom of God might be made known, let's, first of all, who's he made known to? Not by, but to, according to the text. Look at the text again. Made known to whom? The principalities and powers where? And God has some wisdom that he's trying to make the other heavenly beings know. Is that clear from the text? So my question, they're both in the same place. They're both in heaven. Why doesn't God just turn to them and explain it? But notice what the text says. What is his learning device? What's his medium for explanation?
Church.
By the church. God says, there's something about me, there's something about my plan, there's something about my wisdom that you need to know that you cannot learn from simply me telling you. You need to see it for yourselves. He says, now, turn your attention to Exhibit A. I'd like you to notice my people. When you watch them, you're going to learn something you didn't know about me. Apparently, God has designed that his people should teach not just the people on this world, but also the people of other worlds about God. There's an Old Testament parallel to this. It's found in the book of Deuteronomy. Go back to the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 4. Deuteronomy, chapter 4, starting in verse 5. Surely I have taught you statutes and judgments, says, just as the Lord my God commanded me, that you should act according to them in the land which you go to possess. So here, Moses commanding obedience to the Lord's commands, he's saying, look, I taught you the statutes and judgments of God that you should obey them when you go into the land you're going to possess. So notice that I taught you the law of God, and when you obey it, I want you to obey it among these other people who don't know the law of God. Verse 2. You shall not add to the word which I commanded you, nor take from it, that you may keep the commandments of the Lord your God which I commanded you. And he goes on to explain, verse 6. Therefore be careful to observe them, for this is your wisdom where? In the sight of all the peoples who will hear of all these statutes and say, surely this great nation is wise and understanding. He said, people in these surrounding nations are going to be watching you, and you claim to serve as God of love. You serve as God has all these rules, these laws. Let's see what it looks like live out in your life. Saying they're going to be watching you. You should be a witness. Now, here are, for those of you who like obscure references, for our super nerdy people in the room, which I'm sure there's a few here. Here we go. You'll find this one in the Press Collection, page 14. So I want you to know it's really there. She quotes Deuteronomy chapter 4, verses 5 through 8. Then she says these words. Even these words, she's talking about the words of Moses recorded in Scripture, even these words fail of reaching the greatness and the glory of God's purpose to be accomplished through his people. Not to this world only, but to the universe. Are we to make manifest the principles of his kingdom? the third one, 2 Peter chapter 3, what manner of persons ought you to be in all holy conversation with God, that is looking for and hastening the coming of the day of God. She says, you do all these things because the whole universe is watching them. And here's another one, Manuscript 73a, 1900. God desires his people to show by their lives the advantage of Christianity over worldliness. Think about how simple that is. God could just turn to me and be like, oh, trust me, they're going to be fine. Trust me, why am I trying? Just trust me. He says, yes, but I want your faith not to be blind faith. I want it to be built upon clearly seen evidence. Right? Faith in God is not a blind leap into the dark. It's built on a demonstrative evidence. And even the unfallen beings are looking for evidence that God's redemption plan is wise. Again, God desires people to show by their lives the advantage of Christianity over worldliness. Through us, God desires to reveal his manifold wisdom. Lift the phrase right there from Ephesians 3. Therefore, so what does that look like? Into too many seven habits to think, oh, I tell you that, I'm going to reveal the character of God. I'm not going to swear. I'm not going to lose my temper. I'm not going to eat unclean meat. I'm not going to do this. I'm going to take all those bad things and cut them off and all those besetting sins and run the race faithfully. I'm just going to wince up and not do a thing. And the universe will see that I'm a good set of answers. Therefore, he bids us let our light shine forth in what? Good.
Thank you.
void doing. He manifested his good works. He goes on to say, he inculcated God, what's the next word? Principle. That's right, everyone with me at one time. He inculcated the principle. These are two big principles of the universe. He inculcated the principle. The Bible religion does not consist in the mortification of the body. Your righteousness is not simply what you restrict yourself from doing. I want to swear, but since I'm not, I'm being righteous. I want to overeat, but since I'm not, I'm being righteous. I want to drink, I want to smoke, I want to do, but since I'm not. So that is not the definition of pure religion. He goes on, she goes on to say, he taught that pure and undefiled religion, we're going to come back to that phrase, pure and undefiled religion, is not meant only for set times and special occasions, at all times and in all places. He manifested a loving interest in men, shed out the light of cheerful piety. All this was a rebuke to the Pharisees. It, and here's what I love this, showed his life of unselfishness and giving, showed that religion does not consist in selfishness. His life of disinterested beneficence demonstrated the principle of heaven. It showed that religion does not consist in selfishness and that their morbid devotion to personal interest was far from being true godliness. James chapter 1, verse 7. Where did she get that phrase? Pure and undefiled. By the way, this writer is a fantastic writer. She uses these just wonderful, crisp phrases and just articulate right to the point, puts these images in mind. Where did she come up with this particular phrase? Pure and undefiled religion. Came from James chapter 1, verse 7. Pure and undefiled religion before God the Father is this. Here's the definition of perfect religion. And it's got two components. To visit the fatherless and widow in their affliction, and to keep himself unspotted from the world. The Jews were doing one part very, very well. Had no contact with the world. You could never think that they were a friend of sinners. They were not friends to him. They kept themselves unspotted from the world. They completely abandoned the whole fatherless. This is not just a New Testament phenomenon. Please go to Isaiah chapter 58. Isaiah chapter 58. We're getting to some. We're building a theological basis for practical Christian effort in the Seventh-day Adventist Church. But I believe that the message of the Seventh-day Adventist Church must be preached in the method of Christ. Message and method must go together. It can't just be a proclamation. It must be a demonstration. Isaiah chapter 58. I don't know that we have time to read through the whole thing. Well, But basically what you have here is this people seeking the Lord, crying aloud. Verse 2, they seek me daily, and they delight to know my ways. As a nation, they did righteousness, they did not forsake the ordinance of their God. They ask me the ordinance of justice, they take delight in approaching God. So these are people who love to worship God, they love the law of the Lord, they think they're doing great. What's the problem? Verse 3, why have you fasted, they say, and you have not seen me? Why have we afflicted our souls, and you take no notice? Lord, we're fasting, we're afflicting our souls, we're doing nothing bad at all. And yet, we've yet to see that Pentecostal spiritual outpouring of this promise. Why have we fasted and we have not seen? Indeed, in fact, it goes on. Look at God's response in verse 5. Is it a fast that I have chosen? A day for a man to afflict his soul? Is it to bow down his head like a bulrush to spread out sackcloth and ashes? Would you call this a fast and acceptable day of the Lord? He said, all you're doing is praying and seeking and retreating and talking and on and on and on and on and afflicting your soul. You aren't doing anything. Look at verse 6. Is this not the fast that I have chosen? And he said, this is what genuine religion looks like. To loose the bonds of wickedness, to undo the heavy burdens, to let the oppressed go free and the great enough to share your bread with the hungry, and then you bring to your house the poor who are cast out. And you not hide yourself from your own flesh. Then your light shall bring forth like the morning, your healing shall spring forth speedily, and your righteousness shall go before you. The glory of the Lord shall be in your rear guard. Then you shall call, the Lord will answer. You shall cry, and he will say, here I am. To the issue is to cry to the Lord, you never reveal yourself, you never cry your power, you never cry your spirit, and we're sitting here with our souls are crying out, praying, fasting it. He said, but you're not doing anything. Have you done that? Have you reached out to anyone else at all? Or is your spiritual life based on an apprentice of selfishness? This was the problem which Jesus faced long before that particular problem. Apparently, they were so absorbed in their personal spiritual experience that they neglected to do good for others, the good that Israel originally was established to do. Remember? And I will make your name great, you shall be a blessing. He didn't just say, I'm going to bless you. Enjoy. He said, take that blessing and be a blessing to others. Receive to give. Goes on. It seems that they were so intent on being good before God, they neglected to do good for others. Mrs. White has an incredibly huge storehouse of counsel about Isaiah chapter 58. Here are just a few samples. This is found in Welfare Ministry, page 32. The work specified in these words, speaking of Isaiah 58, is the work that God requires his people to do. It is the work of his own appointment. With the work of advocating the commandments of God and repairing the breach that is made in the law of God, so promoting Sabbath keeping, having these great revivals, and having these big proclamation events, with that, we are to mingle compassion for suffering humanity. We are to show supreme love to God. We are to exalt his memorial, which has been drawn down by unholy feet. And with this, we are to manifest mercy, benevolence, and a tender pity for the fallen. Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. Notice these words, as a people. That's all of us. Not just a portion of it, we need a ministry who does this. All of us, as a people. We must take hold of this word. Love revealed for suffering humanity gives significance and power to the truth. Apparently, the Southern Adventist Church was raised up to do more than simply preach truth. To proclaim truth, it was supposed to demonstrate the principle of heaven, to demonstrate the character of God in our lives. Again, Welfare Ministry, the next page, 33. I cannot too strongly urge all our church members, all who are true missionaries. I love that at one point the Seventh-day Adventist mindset, church members and missionaries were equivalent. Right now we have a whole bunch of church members who occasionally send out a missionary. But here, to all church members, all who are true missionaries, all who believe in the very angel's message, all who turn away their feet from the Sabbath to consider the message of 58 chapter by day. The work of beneficence enjoined in this chapter is the work that God requires his people to do at this time. I don't know how language can get any plainer. It is a work of his own appointment. Now, Malachi, page 21. In the 58th chapter of Isaiah, the work that the people of God are to do in Christ's lines is clearly set forth. They are to break every yoke. They are to feed the hungry and clothe the naked. Watch this now. If they carry out the, what's our word? Principles of the law of God in acts of mercy and love, they will represent the character of God to the world and receive the richest blessings of heaven. Apparently, we're called not to proclaim the nature of God, the character of God, but to actually demonstrate it in our lives. What would this look like? And at this point, I just want to make a quick aside. There not just proclamation of the message of God, but actually a revelation of the character of God in good works. What if we did both of those things? Because honestly, I can tell you what's sometimes been in my heart, and I have to be ashamed of it, and I'm sure it's in other hearts too. We look at people who do beneficent work, good for the poor, the homeless shelters, soup kitchens, you know, they're doing good with all the life that they have. But we have a message to preach. Our work is revelations in ours. Their work. See what I'm saying? What would it look like if Seventh-day Adventist people took this on seriously? San Francisco 1901. This is why Rob Adams says, from L.J. O'Horlitz, who is the pastor of the San Francisco Church, we learned that there are many lines of Christian effort being carried forward by our brothers and sisters in San Francisco. And try to count all the activities the San Francisco Seventh-day Adventist Church was employed in 1901. Here it is. These include visiting the sick and the destitute, finding homes for orphans, and work for the unemployed. We look at, oh, that's government work, or they should work hard, they should do that, but that's not church. Nursing the sick and teaching the love of God Christ from house to house. The distribution of literature and the conducting of classes for health, living, and care of the sick. A school for the children is conducted in the basement of the meeting house. In another part of the city, a working man's home. What's a working man's home in modern vocabulary? What is a working man's home today? It's a homeless shelter. A Seventh-day Adventist homeless shelter. In another part of the city, a working man's home and medical mission is maintained. On Market Street near the city hall, there's a bath establishment, which we would think of as a hydrotherapy is operated and ran to the St. Helena Sanitarium. In the same locality is a depot of the health food company, where health foods are not only sold, but instructions given to how as to perform in the diet. Near the center of the city, our people conduct a vegetarian cafe, which is open 6 days a week and is entirely closed on the Sabbath. Here, about 500 meals are served daily, and no flesh meats are used. Dr. and Mrs. Dr. Lamb are doing much medical work for the poor in connection with their regular practice, and Dr. Buchanan is doing much free work at the working man's home. At the medical and dental schools in the city, there are about 20 of our young people in attendance. We earnestly hope, and this is what blew me away, besides the fact that there's like 14 different simultaneous ministries, all doing stuff in San Francisco for one church family, this is her comment on that. She does not say we should bring that in and take the same energy and resources and go to our evangelist crusade. What did she say? We earnestly hope that the steps taken in the future in the work in San Francisco will be steps of progress. The work that has been done there is but a beginning. She looked at all that was going on and she said, that's a really good start. What would she say about my church? Now, she said, you're really doing it. It's a good start you got there, if she called this a good start. San Francisco is the world in itself, and the Lord's work there is to broaden and deepen. The Seventh-day Adventist message and mandate, the mission of our church is both broad and deep. It's not just one or the other. So let's bring a conclusion here. The completeness of Christian character, wouldn't it be nice if there was a litmus test and no one would arrive?
Amen.
I know we like lists. I like to have checklists. love surrounding soul and leader that makes him a savior of life and life and enables God to bless his work. Supreme love for God and unselfish love for one another. This is the best gift that our Heavenly Father can bestow. This love is not an impulse, but a divine, here's our word again, principle. A permanent power. The unconsecrated heart cannot originate or produce it. Only in the heart where Jesus reigns is it found. We love him because he first loved us. In a renewed heart by divine grace, love is the ruling principle of action. Acts of the Apostles 5:51. I have one here that's not in your notes. You just have to listen to it carefully and look it up on your own. It's on Education, page 264. Those who reject the privilege of fellowship with Christ in service reject the only training that imparts a fitness for participation with him in his glory. You can do everything else, but unless you're willing to roll up your sleeves and serve and just give of yourself, it's all about giving, but you still have to form a character that will fit in to the society. And the last one here, Heavenly Places 2:33. God positively enjoins upon all his followers a duty to bless others with their influence and means. In doing for others, a sweet satisfaction will be experienced, and an inward peace which will be sufficient reward. When actuated by a high and noble desire to do others good, they will find true happiness in the faithful discharge of life's manifold duties. This will bring more than an earthly reward, for every faithful, unselfish performance of duty is noticed by whom? By the angels. And it shines. See the implication. They're not watching why Satan should die. They're looking for evidence that he should come there and live. In heaven, none will think of self, nor seek of their own pleasure. How many times have I talked to young people who are terrified of heaven because they'll have to live forever? And what if I get bored? You know, I'm right about this. Shake your head like the pastor, you know what I'm talking about. We talk about 10,000 years later, like, if we're ever going to fit in there, we've got to learn to do it here. Because let me tell you something. When Jesus comes again, you know what new thing we get? We get a new body. Praise the Lord, by the way. I'm just old enough to start wanting a new back. You know, and I could use a couple of new knees. I wouldn't mind a better body. I don't like an eternal one. I'm always going by. But that's what we get when he returns. You know what we don't get? Is a new character. The only thing we take from this world to the next is our character. And it's good to treat our bodies as a temple of the Holy Spirit. It's good to be healthy for us. That's fantastic. We should do that. We should demonstrate that the principles can actually change us physically. But the big physical change is coming in the second coming. The real question is my character like that of Jesus Christ? And not only is it for my selfish interest, how about even getting to think about that question and just doing for others and actually developing character? I like to close this message always in Matthew chapter 25. I can think of no more powerful, no more poignant, no more convincing, no more convicting articulation of what we've been talking about, the circuit of beneficence, the receiving to give, doing for others instead of yourself. And what Jesus himself says about his own return in Matthew chapter 25, verse 31. When the Son of Man comes in his glory, and all the holy angels with him, then he will sit on the throne of his glory. All the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate them one from another, as a shepherd divides the sheep from the goats. So parenthetically, by the way, just living through the second coming is not good enough. least for me. I praise the Lord that I believe Jesus is coming soon, and I want to live through the second coming. But more than that, I want to live through the second coming. Plenty of people will be alive when it happens, but not after it happens. Watch this. Verse 33. And he will set a sheep on his right hand with those on the left. Then the king will say to those on his right hand, come, you blessed my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. And here's why. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me drink. I was a stranger, and you took me in. I was naked, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you visited me. I was in prison, and you came to me. Then the righteous will answer, saying, Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you drink? When did we see you a stranger and take you in, or naked and clothe you? Or when did we see you sick or in prison and come to you? And the king will answer, say to them, surely I say to you, as much as you did in one of the least of these, my brother, you did it to me. Then he will also say to those on his left hand, depart from me, you cursed, into the everlasting fire prepared for the devil and his angels. Please, please, please notice that the fire is not prepared for us. It was prepared for the devil and his angels. There's absolutely no reason any of us need to join in there. But why do this, does this group have that comment? For I was hungry, you gave me no food. I was thirsty, and you gave me no drink. I was a stranger, and you did not take me in. Naked, and you did not clothe me. Sick and in prison, and you did not visit me. Then they will also answer me, saying, Lord, when did we see you hungry or thirsty, or stranger, or naked, or sick, or prison, and did not minister to you? Then he will answer them, saying, surely I say to you, as much as you did not do it to one of these, least of these, you did not do it to me. And these will go away in everlasting punishment, but the righteousness into eternal life. What's astounding to me about this chapter, outside of this incident recorded this passage, is the fact that literally, word for word, the response of the wicked is identical to the response of the righteous. Look at every single word exactly the same. Lord, when did we see you? Right? The righteous say it first, they're like, no. Lord, when did we see you? The wicked fall, then they say the same thing. Lord, when did we see you? And they say, Lord, when did we see you? It's almost, if we had known it was you, we would have put up a potluck. We would have done canned food drives. We would have done prison ministry. We would have done community services. We would have had homeless shelters. You name it, we would have done it if we knew it was you. beneficent character of God. Lord, let Seventh-day Adventism be known as that movement who just doesn't avoid evil, but they do good. When people see us, they no longer see us. They see Christ in us.